Welcome back, everyone. Resuming the session two of this training, it's my proud privilege and honor to welcome Dr. Marco Cristano and Dr. Jerome Benveniste at this webinar today. We have all recognized them as remote sensing satellite experts. Dr. Marco and Dr. Jerome need no introduction, and any introduction will fail to do justice to their personalities like them. Nevertheless, I will make a try to introduce them with you all. Dr. Marco has developed his experience in radar altimetry while working at the Sapienza University of Rome, where he got his PhD in radar remote sensing in 2014 on Mars exploration with ESA Mars Express radars. He joined the altimetry team at the European Agency at Earth Observation Center in Frascati near Rome, Italy in 2015. He gave many lectures to teach radar altimetry, and he's co-author of many publications. Whereas Dr. Jerome received his PhD in oceanography from space from the University of Toulouse, France in 1989. After postdoc in space data assimilation in ocean models at MIT Boston University, USA. He has been at the European Center Agency Earth Observation Data Center near Rome, Italy since 1992, where he is the in charge of the ERS-1, ERS-2, Sentinel-3, Sentinel-6, and NVSAT radar altimetry data exploitation.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Marco Restano. I work as a SARCO consultant for radar altimetry at the European Space Agency in Frascati, Italy, ESA ESRIN, and I'm presenting this contribution about altimetry for inland water investigations, data acquisition, processing, analysis using the SAR Altimetry Processing On Demand Service for CryoSat-2 and Sentinel-3 at ESAR Console Altimetry Virtual Lab. A few colleagues provided some support to prepare this presentation. Martina Wenzel, former YGT at ESA ESRIN, Urania Altiparmaki, researcher at TU Delft, Karina Nielsen, researcher at DTU Space, moreover, Jerome Benveniste, the ESA technical officer I am associated with. Jerome is responsible for shaping, launching and managing ESA research projects on radar altimetry for both the improvement of processing baselines and the development of advanced altimetry products. Then the Earth Console team, who managed the implementation of the Earth Console Altimetry Virtual Lab and also injected all the altimetry processors we will discuss in this presentation in the Altimetry Virtual Lab platform. Regarding the first section, this will be about radar altimetry fundamentals and missions. The scenario in which we operate is typically the ocean. So we start from the ocean and then we move to the inland water altimetry. First of all, please consider that our system is mounted on an orbiting platform. So we fly along an orbit which has to be known with very good accuracy, less than 2 centimeters, and this is done by considering external data from laser stations, Doris station and GPS satellites. The framework in which we operate includes an ellipsoid over which all our measurements are referred. And please consider that with the altimeter we measure this quantity, which is the range and which is affected by the propagation into the ionosphere and troposphere. Once the satellite altitude is known with respect to the ellipsoid with the required accuracy, by doing the subtraction between the satellite altitude and the range, we obtain the so-called sea surface height, which is referred to the ellipsoid, and can be referenced also to the geoid by subtracting the geoid and by obtaining this quantity. The geoid is very important to obtain orthometric water levels in the inland water domain, and geoids are obtained for other, from external missions, other missions, typically grays and gauss. And for the inland water domain, no accurate water level can be obtained without an accurate geoid. In particular, regarding the geophysical corrections to be applied on the range measurements, you see these are many. We are not discussing these corrections in detail, this would require too much time, but please keep in mind the importance of the wet tropospheric correction, especially for the inland water domain. You can see here that the associated error can reach quite significant values, 45 centimeters. Then we have instrumental corrections, surface corrections, and other adjustments to be considered. So we need plenty of information to derive a correct range measurement. Regarding the directions of interest, we will be discussing the resolutions in the various directions. So it's important to define them. And we fly with an instrument which is mounted on a platform, and this platform is flying in a specific direction. We call this a long track direction over which the instrument flies. The perpendicular direction is named a cross track direction, and we perform measurements through this other direction, which is the nadir direction. Okay, so don't be confused, because this is just a figure. We are not using a side-looking system like a radar imager, but we are looking at nadir using a satellite altimetry system. So again, direction of flight is the along track direction, perpendicular one is the across track direction. Please keep them in mind. In terms of missions, this started way back in the 70s, mostly for the observation of the ocean. So you see, at the moment we have several missions in green which are available, and along with them there is also this Sentinel-6 mission. And as it will be clarified in the next slides, these altimeters have a different capability in terms of resolution. The system using the older systems are those using the low resolution mode, and these are up to JSON-3, and also Saral Altica uses this low resolution mode. Then the other missions like Cryosat, Sentinel-3, Sentinel-6, they implement the SAR mode, which is a first step above the LRM to improve the along track resolution, as we will see in a moment. In particular, Cryosat 2 includes three modes: the low resolution mode, the SAR mode, and the SAR-in mode, which is the SAR interferometric mode with two antennas. In particular, the new mission Sentinel-6 adopts a new transmission mode, interleaved mode, and allows obtaining simultaneously SAR and LRM waveforms. The discussion would require some time to explain this, so just take this message for your future readings on altimetry. Regarding the availability of products, it's important to distinguish between, for instance, the Sentinel-3 mission and the Cryosat-2 mission. Here you see Sentinel-3A and Sentinel-3B tracks overlaid on Google Earth, and you see that there is a typical pattern, okay, for the tracks for Sentinel-3 and A and Sentinel-3B. In case of Cryosat, the mission operates in these three modes: LRM, SAR, and SAR-in, and there is a mode mask implemented by the Cryosat. Cryosat mission manager, essentially, to cope with the need of the altimetry community. So it means that you don't have data everywhere with Cryosat, but you have data only in these regions, and the color identifies one of these three modes: SAR, SAR-in, and LRM. Please also keep in mind that the repeat cycle plays an important role, and for instance, if you have you consider Sardinia here, we have Sentinel-3, it means that we are crossing, for instance, the island today, and the repeat cycle of Sentinel-3 is 27 days, so after 27 days we will be back here to acquire another measurement. For Cryosat-2, the repeat cycle is roughly 1 year, And so it's a bit more complicated to obtain to derive, for instance, for the inland water domain time series, which have a good sampling, because a measurement every year it's not something that you want to use for your hydrologic application. Anyway, there are also interesting works to be read about the use of CryoSat-2. Then about the other missions, the JSON series and the Sentinel-6 series, they have a repeat cycle of 10 days. About NVSAT and this one and Sarala LTK, you have a repeat cycle of 35 days, and this is it. So 27, Sentinel-3, JSON 10 days, CryoSat 1 year, and this is a first overview on the missions. Regarding the processing schemes, so the low resolution mode, it's important to distinguish how we look at the surface and how which is the strategy to look at the target. Essentially, the low resolution mode uses a pulse limited acquisition, in the sense that the time on target is dictated by the pulse illumination on the surface. The surface is illuminated by the antenna, sorry, in this blue surface. Blue area. At a certain point, the pulse is transmitted. We transmit a Ku band pulse, a chirp signal. Essentially, this pulse propagates into the space, the free space. Then, at a certain point, we open the receiving window. The pulse starts interacting with the surface. So, we start by receiving nothing, so we have noise in the receiver. As the backscattering phenomena evolves, we receive energy back to the radar, and there is the creation of a first leading edge, which reaches a maximum value at the formation of the pulse limited footprint, and then the power decays. Actually, it should stay constant, but the antenna gain is maximum at nadir, and it has a lower gain at the border of the antenna. So that's why this power is reduced as the time increases. This variation from a full circle to an anomaly is due to the fact that at a certain point the trailing edge of the transmitted pulse will be reached, so the interaction will stop in this area and the propagation will continue just at the border of the illuminated area, and the area should stay constant, but because of the antenna gain the power will drop. It's important to keep in mind that the parameters that we want to estimate, so the range we have seen in the first figure, this one, the range, and the significant wave height, which is the peak-to-peak height of an ocean wave, the next slide will clarify, and the wind speed are obtained by considering parameters, by considering this portion of the received pulse. So it's important to note that all this power, which is higher, it's not used for the estimation, and so it's wasted in this LRM mode. In terms of resolution in along and across track, the value is the same, and it's about several kilometers depending on the sea state. So if the sea is rough, we have a certain resolution, very high, usually, so, sorry, very low, so the resolution can be around 12, 16 kilometers, whereas if the surface is flat, so a very calm sea, the significant wave height is close to zero, and so the resolution is better, around 2 kilometers, for instance. Now, let's look a bit more in detail about why we have a certain waveform received by the radar. If you imagine to have a flat surface, you have this line. If you imagine some roughness, the ocean wave will turn to be like this. How is this mapped in your waveform? Essentially, if you have a flat surface, the significant wave height is zero, and so the power will be backscattered all at once by the surface, and the return will be fully coherent, and so you will have a very high power, and it will be captured immediate, so in a very short amount of time. If you have some roughness, the peak-to-peak structure will indicate the need of we request more time. So in the sense that first we have to receive the return from here and then from here, and this will take some time. And so you see that the time to receive the power from this scenario increases a lot, and these numbers are related to the significant weight height. So if the significant weight height is very high, the sea is very rough and it takes more time to receive the power, and the actual maximum value will be lower than in case of a flat surface. Then the other values were the amplitude, which is here, the maximum of the waveform, and the amplitude maximum can be related to the sigma zero and to the wind speed. So it means that if I have wind, the surface will be rougher and the power will be lower. If the surface of the sea is flat, the power will be coherent, will be very strong, and so I'll have different power values that I will interpret as the case of the absence of wind, because a very flat surface is not shaped by the presence of any wind. Then this middle point here is dictated actually to the range we discussed before, and you see that in all cases, in all sea states, from flat to rough, all the curves intersect here at the midpoint. And so it means that the range measurement will be the same in all cases. Now, the SAR mode. The SAR mode is needed because we want to improve the long track resolution to this 2 to 12, 16 kilometers value, up to a value which is around 300 meters. And this is possible because we use this synthetic aperture processing and exploiting the Doppler effect. Essentially, the time on target in this case is not dictated by the pulse, but it's dictated by the beam illumination. And we can do this processing just exploiting the motion over the orbit, along the orbit, so it's an analog track processing. And this can be exploited by using a specific transmission scheme which is based on pulses. So instead of transmitting a pulse and receiving a pulse, we transmit a burst of 64 pulses, and this is valid only for Sentinel-3 and Cryosat-2. And essentially, you see here 64 pulses transmitted plus 2 C pulses for the ionospheric estimation. The SAR processing allows to split the antenna beams in 64 sub-beams, which, thanks to the Doppler effect, relate the signal received from a certain position of the antenna on ground projected area. So we can relate, thanks to this Doppler effect, the signal here to this specific beam, and the signal here to another specific beam. So we can control essentially the power coming from each of the beams. And this is very useful because essentially, if we consider that we will observe a single point of ground and we will overfly the point with the radar, by applying this SAR processing, at every position I will have this split of the antenna beam within several sub-beams. And so it means that I can use in this position the red beam to observe the backscattering from this direction, and in the successive transmissions I can observe the response of the backscattering response in all the other directions. So this allows me to create a stack, so-called, by using all these different looks in different colors. Usually we have around 220 looks to form this so-called stack. And then by doing a multi-looking, which is the incoherent averaging of all these looks, so we can reduce the speckle noise, improve the signal-to-noise ratio, and improve the long track resolution in comparison to the LRM mode. So the big advantage is that the long track resolution gets to a value which is around 300 meters, and that is independent from the significant weight height. In particular, we start by injecting L1A data, or FBR for Cryosat-2 products, in this processor, and we end up ending the so-called L1B products, which are the output of the SAR processor. Essentially, it's important to keep in mind that the benefits are those reported in this figure, in the sense that if we compare the conventional LRM waveform with the so-called delay Doppler or unfocused SAR waveform, you see immediately that the SNR is way higher, and that the power that we wasted in the alarm case is now absent in the SAR, because the SAR after the peak tends to drop immediately, and so there is no power wasted, or the power wasted is way less. And it's important to point out that if you will study the SAR processing more in detail, what it happens is that you relocate the power, which is located here, wasted in LRM, in the leading edge of the final SAR waveform. This would take some time to be explained, but it goes like this. And essentially, you make a very good use of the power, increasing the SNR in the portion of the waveform which is needed for the estimation of the significant weight height, the range, and the sigma zero. This is a clear example. Now, it's important also to consider some parameters that are associated with these waveforms, and one parameter of interest is the pulse peakiness, which is an F1B parameter measuring the peakiness of the waveform, which is clearly accentuated over the flat surfaces and can be used for filtering purposes, as we will see. So, pulse peakiness is very high in this case. It will be very low if we have contamination in the waveform, which means that we will have several spikes instead of one. And then another thing that I want to point out is that all depends in terms of waveform shape by the scenario you're looking at. So we will have a shape which is typical over the inland water domain. We will have a shape which is typical for the ocean domain, the coastal zone, and so on. And so different scenario produce different F1B waveforms, and then need different retrackers, which is the subsequent processing step, the L2 level that we will see in a few slides, to correctly estimate the range, the significant weight height, and the sigma zero. Now, the next slide is about the fully focused SAR, which is the latest development in this sense. The fully focused SAR is something that exploits the coherence of the waveform and the phase, and it's important because here we are redoing something which is done, for instance, by the spot satellites for imaging. So we integrate the signals for a time of 2 seconds, putting in correct phase all the contributions, and so refacing the array of a very long synthetic antenna. And this allows to obtain a reduction in the along track resolution from 300 meters, which is the unfocused SAR, to 0.5 meter maximum, which is the fully focused SAR. So the footprint in comparison for the three modes that we have studied can be seen here. And essentially, you see that if this is the along track direction, you have that the conventional altimetry has this 16 kilometer of diameter footprint. In case of the unfocused SAR, you get an along track footprint reduced to 300 meters, and in case of FFSAR, you get 0.5 meters. In all cases, the across track resolution stays the same, and this is clear because the SAR processing is done only in the along track direction, so this cannot be changed, this cannot be improved. Then, in terms of comparison between the delay Doppler we have seen here and the fully focused processed waveform, you see that the peakiness is more accentuated as expected, and there is a better use of power. Now, the power is normalized here, but as you imagine, the SNR for the fully focused waveform is even higher than the unfocused delay Doppler. You find more information in this reference paper. Now, a quick look: if you have a pond and this is the along track direction, you see the difference between FFSAR and unfocused SAR. So, in case of the unfocused SAR, you have here again the along track direction. These are the 300 meters along track resolution, and sorry, here you have the across track resolution, which is quite wide and may include, as it is in this case, the contribution of additional water bodies. This will contaminate the waveform. When you use the fully focused SAR, you reduce the footprint in the along track direction. It stays the same in a cross track direction, and the footprint contamination will be probably present, but its intensity will be lower because in any case the area has been reduced a lot, and so also the contribution coming from this contaminating source will be reduced. You find more information in this paper. Now, regarding the coastal zone, and this coastal zone gives us the opportunity to discuss a bit more the corruption of the waveforms, as I was introducing to you a few slides ago. Essentially, waveforms acquired in the coastal zone and inland water domain can be significantly distorted due to the presence of land in the footprint. So it means that if you have the footprint here, as long as it contains only water, this is a typical LRM waveform in which you have noise, leading edge, and trailing edge, as seen before. You have no contamination, so you can approach the coast in this direction along track again. And then at a certain point you will meet the land, so the footprint will include the land. Well, in that case you have a corruption of the waveform because you will have some multiple peaks creating problems, and the estimates that you may derive from the retracking of this waveform are not reliable. So an example instead for the SAR case, if you consider this waveform perfectly positioned in the receiving window, again noise, again leading edge for the estimation of the parameters and the trailing edge, you see that when you are over the open ocean, waveforms are perfect. When you are approaching, see the number and compare. At the coastal zone, there are some spikes, and so this corruption of the waveform can create problems in the parameters, even if the leading edge is in a good shape, and this will be clarified in a moment. Then again, this has been explained, and the waveform shape has to be checked for filtering purposes, also in relation to a parameter named misfit that will be introduced in the next slides. And this indicates the posting of the final products. We have an altimeter waveform at every point, and the distance, the separation between the two points, or the two waveforms if you want, is dictated by the SAR processor. In case of a posting rate of 20 Hz, you have a separation between two estimates, or two waveforms like these two, of 300 meters, but this will be reminded to you later in a specific slide. Now, you saw in the previous slide that the waveforms were perfectly centered in the receiving window, but this is something that we have to discuss because actually is something which is dictated by the system. Essentially, what you have is a tracking algorithm which sets the tracking window, the receiving window, at the correct position. So, if the radar works autonomously, we consider an onboard algorithm which is named closed loop, which operates the closed loop mode. And it automatically centers the receiving signal into the receiving window by using the information from preceding echoes. So, if you imagine a satellite flying from the right to the left, it correctly set the information of the height here, so is able following the profile very well, but at this point there is an issue because there is an abrupt variation of the height. The signal loses the track of the surface, so instead of receiving the pulses on the water, it still opens the receiving window here and receives no information because actually it's taking more time for the pulse to get back. And so instead of having this signal here, you will have an empty receiving window. It takes some time for the closed loop tracking mode to find the correct position again and track correctly the water body. Okay? And this is the so-called closed loop mode. Instead, in the recent radars, such as Sahalaltika Sentinel-3, there is a new mode, named DODM mode, which is the so-called open loop tracking mode, and which has been implemented, for instance, in these two consecutive cycles of Sahalaltika. So, in this case, as you can imagine, you have the cycle related to the closed loop, which loses the track when there is an abrupt variation of the topography, and then here instead you have the open loop in which there is the information of a DEM stored on board is used to correctly set the position of the tracking window. And so, as you can imagine, this is very important for your inland water investigations, because if the tracking window is badly positioned, the results that you are obtaining are bad, in the sense that you could have no data, empty receiving window, you could have the data because you are lucky, or you can have a waveform which is cut. And in any case, it's not usable, or the estimates that you get from the retracker on this waveform are wrong. More information can be found about these two figures in this paper. Now, for Sentinel-3 especially, it's important to report that the mission initially started with the closed loop mode implemented. Then later there was the open loop, which was tested and implemented. Information on the tracking adopted for a specific region of time, a specific region and time of interest can be found at this link, and the reference paper is this one. So I invite you to check the information reported on this website for your specific case to see if the radar was working in closed loop or in open loop, and have a clue about the quality of the data that you may get. Regarding a slide to summarize the impact of wave contamination and the importance of using the correct onboard tracking mode, please consider these two figures starting from the one on the left. So, if you remember this figure we have seen a few slides ago, you have a series of LRM waveforms in approaching the coast in this direction. And if we consider all these waveforms in a matrix, so we can create the so-called radargram. So this dark blue corresponds to this level of noise. Then there is a leading edge here, which reaches a maximum when we have the red power values, and then the power decays here. And so at a certain point we have the satellite approaching the coast, and you see that this is a distortion of all the waveforms, like this one in red. And this happens for the LRM mode, which is implemented in Sentinel-3 as a pseudo LRM mode, which is obtained from SAR through a specific processing. You can see that the waveforms get contaminated from around 7 km to the coast. Then, if you consider instead the SAR processing 300 m resolution in a long track, it takes much more time to have the waveform contaminated, and so you can get closer to the coast, which means that usually you get usable data up to 2 km or 1.5 km. It all depends by the morphology, it all depends by the F1B processing you performed. It will depend also by the retrackers that you will implement to retrieve your estimates of range, significant wave height, and amplitude sigma 0. Instead, if you consider the impact of the tracking mode here from in a typical case in which you are leaving the land and entering the sea, so in this direction, in case of closed loop, the radar is struggling in finding correct data over land because of the reason we have discussed in the previous slide. And then after a while, after having left the coast, after a while, correctly resets the position of the receiving window and receives the correct data. For the open loop, it is guided by DM, so it doesn't receive anything here, but as it approaches the coastal zone, you see that it starts immediately to recover some data. And so it clearly works better in this mode. Okay. So now the so-called retracking, very important to extract the range, significant wave height, and wind speed from the L1B SAR waveform or LRM waveform. So the idea is that you consider first of all the altimetry signal, typical LRM waveform, again noise, leading edge, and trailing edge of the LRM waveform with a lot of wasted power. And the retracking can be of two types: the physical retracking, which considers all the elements from the specs of the instrument to the interaction with the ocean surface, so it models the sea state and considers basically everything, all the instrument parameters and all the possible sea states. In this case, we refer to physical retrackers that will be labeled later in an analysis with the name Samosa retrackers, which have been developed in past ESA projects. And essentially, these are the best ray trackers because they consider all the possible influences on the return echo. And as you can see here, we are basically performing the retrieval of the three parameters of interest by performing a fitting. Essentially, what these ray trackers do is the following. We have several options to create several C states and so simulate the C at various with various possible environments, from flat C to rough C. And so we create a population of models respecting and reproducing these C states, and then we test all these models by fitting the model waveform in red here to the altimetry signal. We test a lot of models, and the best fitting one is our choice for a representation of the current of the actual altimetry signal, and so a representation of the actual C state, and we retrieve and we take in output the model wind speed, the model epoch, which is related to the range, and the model leading edge slope, which is related to the significant wave height. And this is important because, as you can imagine, it's very accurate, especially in over the ocean when you have where you have no contamination. And so, for instance, Sentinel-3 uses the Samosa 2 model, which is very good in the open ocean. Then we have the Samosa Plus and Samosa Plus Plus analytical ray trackers. Physical tracker, sorry, that perform better in case of contamination, so in the coastal zone or in the inland water domain. And it's important that when you evaluate a fitting, you can also retrieve a parameter named misfit, which tells you about the quality of the fit. And so, if the misfit is a value lower than 4, lower than 3.5 for the Samosa family, you are sure that the values that you are obtained from the fitting are reliable. If not, if the misfit is higher, like higher than 4, this is typically related to waveforms which include multiple peaks from contamination. This value indicates that the estimates that you are getting for the ray tracker, even if they are provided, are wrong and should not be used. So we will see in our analysis that the misfit has to be checked to filter out the data. Another possibility is represented by the empirical ray trackers, so the OCOG, the threshold, or the bad ray tracker, and they work on the statistics of the waveform. So they don't consider the interaction phenomena, they don't consider the specs of the altimeter, and they just make some calculations on the waveform. For instance, retrieving this W, this A, these parameters. Then every ray tracker is, of course, specific, so you have to check the associated documentation. But they retrieve the leading end position, they retrieve the amplitude, they cannot return the slope, and so they cannot provide the significant wave height, but they are very easy to be implemented, and they do not return any misfit because, of course, there is no model that fits the returned waveform in this case. So the L2 products are created after this ray tracking process and include the significant wave height, the range, the amplitude, is also the sigma zero that can be related to the wind speed, and they include all the geophysical corrections that you have to use to correct the range value provided by the ray tracker, as indicated in the very first slide about the altimetry fundamentals. Important, the ALS adaptive leading edge subwaveform ray tracker. So far we have discussed full waveform ray trackers, so waveforms ray tracker that consider the full waveform. You see that the fitted signal here covers from the beginning to the end. And so it means that if here I have some contamination, this fitting will not succeed as I want, and so the model will extract wrong values. In case of else, the fitting is performed with a physical model, but it's performed up to the beginning of the leading edge. Then it is stopped because this part is not considered in order to avoid the influence of the contamination. And so it's a ray tracker conceived for the coastal zone, essentially. And you can see here a comparison against the JSON-1 SGDR estimates. And what you can see is that the percentage of outliers is reduced in case of ALS because it's way lower than the official JSON-1 product, especially in these areas which are the coastal zones. And so you see the big difference. And instead, in the open ocean, the turret trackers perform mostly the same because there is no contamination, and so it is expected that also the official red tracker perform very well. And so you see that we need specific red trackers for specific scenarios. You find more information about the ALES in this paper. Now, the output products. I said that they will include the output from the red trackers, for example, the range. Associated with a specific ray tracker, CIS ray tracker, OCOG ray tracker empirical, Ocean ray tracker, the Samosa 2, this is a typical case of Sentinel-3 product, or the ICE ray tracker. The band can be the Ku band, the C band, because we transmit also in C band, and this is an important value about the posting rate, 20 Hz or 1 Hz. So, for the LRM mode products, you have the estimates posted along the track at a certain intervals in space. If the posting rate is 1 Hz, the separation between two points is around 7 km. If you have a 20 Hz posting rate, you have 300 meters, and please, please don't confuse these 300 meters with the resolution in SAR, because these are two different things, okay? So when I say 20 Hz posting rate, I mean 300 meters separation between two estimates, and this can exist both in SAR or in LRM mode. Then a thing that I will point out in the analysis I will present is that the AmFocus-SAR and FF-SAR products can be made available also at higher posting rates, for instance 80 Hz, which means 80 meters between two estimates and in a long track, or higher posting rates in the case of FF-SAR. Typically, these high posting rates products are not provided by the ground segment. This is a ground segment, but can be processed in the Earth Console Ultimate Virtual Lab. And this screenshot has been obtained with the Panoply software from NASA, along with all the figures I have displayed, for instance, here, in these cases here. This is the output of the Panoply software that I will link to you at the end of this presentation. Now, before concluding this overview on altimetry fundamentals, it's important to underline that every time we perform an analysis and we obtain some estimates from our L2 ray tracker, we need to compare the estimates to in situ or to reliable data to see if our analysis is correct or not. So, in terms of reference data, we use gauge data that can be tide gauge data when we are at the coast, or river gauge data when we are in the inland water domain, or lake gauge data over a lake. Essentially, the gauges locally measure relative sea level, so, and they measure absolute sea level only if they are referenced to the ellipsoid that we have discussed at the very beginning, with a GPS, and the GPS data are also useful to correct the so-called vertical land motion. The measurements can be acquired every 10 minutes, every 30 minutes, every hour, it depends by the provider, and they work with a specific datum, usually, that can be different from the one used in altimetry products. To align the two references, the two datums, you can use tools like this from NOAA. And it's important because you have to align the datums. And if this is not possible, you have to demean separately the two time series by subtracting the mean from each set of observation, so they are at zero mean, and then you can compare the data. Here is a case of comparison from a tide gauge located in New Haven, which is Great Britain. And here you see that the comparison between the mean time series is very good, below 10 centimeters up to 18 kilometers from the coast, and then it increases because the sea state is different. So here we have two different sea states, as can be seen, and with the altimetry track we can cover both regions close to the tide gauge and both regions in the open ocean. Now let me tell you something about the ESA Earth Console Altimetry Virtual Lab processors for inland water altimetry before proceeding with our analysis. Essentially, the Earth Console Altimetry Virtual Lab, funded by ESA, aims at providing a virtual space to support the altimetry community in the development and operation of new Earth observation applications, fostering collaboration by leveraging on knowledge sharing tools. The Altimetry Virtual Lab has been developed on the new Earth Console platform and hosts the Salvatore which stands for SAR Versatile Altimetric Toolkit for Research and Exploitation, a Salvatore family of processors, which was previously available in the ESA GPOD environment. The Altimetry Virtual Lab ensures service continuity following the recent termination of the GPOD environment. The driving concept is to offer the same processing capabilities formerly available in ESA GPOD, while improving the user experience by combining the access to innovative, fully customizable altimetry data processing services from a single environment at the push of a button, and also the availability of a set of tools to network with colleagues, keep up with the latest news and publications on radar altimetry, and share results to avoid the application of efforts. And also combines the flexibility of a virtual space, which can be further reshaped following the future emerging needs of the community. In particular, Altimetry Virtual Lab users can request and access through the Gbox service, sorry, a virtual machine for algorithm development, testing, and post-processing analysis. Each virtual machine also includes software for altimetry data analysis and visualization, like BRAT, which is the Broadview Altimetry Toolbox. And essentially, it allows you opening altimetry products and performing some simple analysis. And then Panoply, we have discussed the Panoply now, and also Python. Then users can request to access and process data with the following processors, which have been integrated and are ready for use. This will be discussed during the analysis sections. And also users can request to integrate through the IAP service additional processors. So access a set of tools to network and share information and results with colleagues is also possible. We provide a forum, a data repository to download data which have been already processed for the community. And then we provide also a knowledge base with relevant altimetry publications and media for consultations. So as you can see, there are several sections in this Altimetry Virtual Lab. Now, if you want to register and use the Altimetry Virtual Lab, please follow the instructions made available in this brochure, which is downloadable at the provided link. And also keep in mind that the user manual can be downloaded from this link. Now, a quick overview on the processing services. Here I attached some screenshots for your convenience to show you how you can access the services once you have registered. For instance, the fully focused SAR for CREOSA 2 service by Aresis can be accessed, and the interface is typically very, very simple to be understood. It includes a map. You can draw your region of interest. You can query for the data, then set a series of processing options, submit the processing, and follow your task, the status here. When it turns green, the task is completed, and you can access the data by clicking on the I reported here. Then a quick overview of the processing services. Again, some other example from the Salinvatore service, and you can see once you have defined the region of interest, you can query for the different orbits, select the data, select the processing options, and then you can submit the processing. Please take into account that these options are explained in detail in the software user manual that is available in this at this link. Okay, and now we can start with the investigations. So inland water investigations using the AVL Salvatore data. First, we start with the unfocused SAR for inland water. And this is the work performed by Martina Wenzel at ESA Estrin during her YGT period. And it's about data selection, filtering, and processing over the Great Salt Lake in the US. As you can see, here we have followed this flow chart. This was developed back then during the GPOD years. Now, this should report our console AVL platform. In any case, we have two different flows for the processing of the data. In the first flow, we have the A1B SAR processing in GPOD in Earth Console Altimetry Virtual Lab Salvatore for Sentinel-3 service. And we selected this inland water HPR profile with 22 beams in the stack, which provides HPR high posting rate data at 8 years. And then these 8 years data are retracted, the waveforms which are produced are retracted with two retrackers from the Samosa family. So, two physical retrackers tailored for the inland water domain or the coastal zone, Samosa Plus and Samosa Plus Plus. The data are taken, the estimates are taken, then these are filtered using a water mask that you see here. There is a bridge between these two parts of the Great Salt Lake, and so we have prepared two separated water masks using this Map Window 5 software, which is very good and produces data that can be easily read in Python with the Shapley library. And then once we have selected the data, we have used the pulse peakiness, for instance, and the mean misfit to filter out the data. It's clear that if you consider this track and this associated radargram, when you are close to the land here at the beginning of the lake, close to a bank, you will have pulses, shapes of waveforms which are contaminated and very low in power. And so this for sure will have a very low pulse peakiness, and the misfit will be also very bad because the retrackers are not conceived to retrack corrupted waveform. So there will be no model correctly fitting this shape, and so the misfit will be very high. And then over the lake you will have a different kind of waveforms which are very good, very peaky. And you see that in all cases they are very well centered in the receiving window. So in this case we will have a very high pulse peakiness and also a very low misfit. And so the power is way higher in this case than in this other case, in case of contamination, so close to this point. Then, to conclude, these are the equations used for this first flow, and you have the sea surface height equal uncorrected sea surface height, which is basically the difference between altitude and range. Then we apply all the corrections and we derive the orthometric height by applying the geoid. Again, geo corrections are retrieved here by interpolating the 1 Hz value provided in Salvatore products. And please keep in mind again this wet tropospheric correction and try to check to visualize the values of the corrections and how they evolve over a water body to see if the corrections are correct or not, because this can ruin your analysis. You have to be very careful in checking all the ingredients you put in your equations. The other flow is about using the official SentinelT processing, so posting rate at 20 Hz, 300 meters separation between two estimates, and then using the ELS plus R retracking, which is the subwaveform retracker we discussed before in its extension to SAR waveforms. Again, same water mask applied, the same criteria, and same derivation of the sea surface height for the ELS case. We considered four filtering strategies. The first is not applying any filtering strategy, just the water mask. And then we applied only the misfit, only the pulse peakiness, or both together. You see that we consider good waveforms which have a misfit low, below 3.5, and we consider good waveforms which have a pulse peakiness above 0.2. So these are the conditions for the acceptance of the waveforms. Okay, so now I will compare just in a slide the unfiltered data to those we have that have been filtered, including all the conditions. So compare case 0 and case 3. Now, Samosa Plus, Samosa Plus Plus, and ELS Plus R. Here you see the altimetry estimates in red and the in situ data in yellow. The time series have been the mean, because we were having problems in aligning the datums, and so we preferred that we use the demeaning as typically made by the community. So a few parameters of interest are the correlation coefficient, the root mean square error, and the standard deviation. You can see that between Samosa Plus and Samosa Plus Plus, Samosa Plus performs better with a higher correlation and a lower root mean square, and also a lower standard deviation of the measurements. Instead, the ELS plus R performs pretty well between the two, with values that are in the middle if you consider these two cases, 0.74 and 0.13 and 0.13 again. This is the case for the unfiltered data. For the filtered data, I expect the results to improve because we are selecting just the best waveforms, and so you see that the Samosa plus improves just a bit, it stays mostly the same in its results. For the case of the filtered Samosa plus plus, we had this and now we have this, so it has improved much more. So Samosa plus plus needs more filtering, so it seems from this analysis. DRMS has improved just slightly, whereas Else plus R is not has not improved. So the results are a bit worse than before. But please consider that Else is able to perform very well, especially in the coastal zone where contamination is present. In this case, over a big lake such as the Great Salt Lake, we have very clean waveforms like this, and so having a sub-waveform retracker actually doesn't add a great value. But in any case, the results that this retracker has provided are pretty good. And please consider that S plus R at the beginning was not conceived for the inland water domain, so it was just a test from our side. Now, the FFSAR for inland water investigation, a work made by Urania Altiparmaki, TU Delft. In this case, we do not consider any in situ data. It's just a comparison between the FFSAR developed at TU Delft and the FFSAR developed by ARESIS for GPOD using a different approach named Omega K, which is a faster implementation. It takes way less time to produce the data, and the back projection, which is the first algorithm for the FFSAR that has been developed in the reference paper I provided in the first slide about the fully focused SAR. And unfortunately, this algorithm is pretty slow. The retracker used to compare both is the Threshold Peak retracker, which is an empirical retracker very easy to be implemented in Python. It takes, a couple of hours to have it working. And then this is the first set of tests, and you can see the results over this lake Isel in the Netherlands. And you can see that I'm not discussing in detail the specs, but basically it's the typical evaluation of standard deviation and bias. And you see that the two data set, GPOD and TU Delft, perform pretty much the same in terms of performances. So, and there is not much to be discussed except that the ARESIS FFSAR available on the Earth console is pretty much aligned. And then in another test, FFSAR GPOD and the UnFocus SAR GPOD, so the two processors that you have in Earth console now, from ARESIS and from Salvatore for UnFocus SAR, have been tested using a posting rate of 20 Hz, imposing a posting rate of 20 Hz during the SAR processing, and by using two different retrackers, Samosa++ and the Threshold Peak retracker used for the fully focused SAR data. As you can see here, without discussing the options that, as I told you, you can check the manual, there is a data editing for the outlier removal, which is not different from the typical approaches, 3 times the standard deviation from the median or this other one. And this is just to say that apart from the bias that of course can be present, you can see that the results are aligned in terms of the oscillations that you have, the precisions of the data. And so that's what we wanted to see. Of course, the 20 Hz estimates include the less estimates, one every 300 meters. And so the level of noise is also lower, whereas for the FFSAR estimates, no matter the tracker you use, you have more estimates, and also the noise is a bit higher. 100 Hz means a separation between two estimates of 60 meters, roughly 60 meters. And so this is another possibility to check the precision of the data. Now, actually, this is not an easy mission, but it's important for you working in the inland water, in the inland water domain, because it provides high quality data. I will not spend too much time on this, but just to give you a very quick provide a very quick overview of these sensors. ISA2 generates individual laser footprints of nearly 14 meters in diameter, so a very good value, way lower than the 300 meters of SAR. Not as good as fully focused SAR, but it's an excellent value for inland water investigations. And then each footprint is separated by only 70 centimeters, and it offers a much higher resolution in comparison to the previous ISAT mission, which ended in 2010. Essentially, the LIDAR works using 6 beams that you see here, and they transmit different powers. So the weak is the one transmitting less power, and then the strong beam is the one transmitting more power. They are separated as reported in this figure. And it's important that from the ground segment you get this L2 products, which has later worked to produce several subproducts, and one is related to the inland water domain. This is the product ATL13. Importantly is this fact is first of all the ATL13 product is tailored for inland water bodies which are of this entity. So they have these sites and they have this width for the rivers, but the products in NetCDF, as we will see in a moment, have a subset for each beam, which can be the strong beam or the weak beam with this L or R. So they are diversified with this letter, and the 1, 2, 3 is related to the pair, essentially the first pair, the second pair, the first pair, the second pair, then the third pair. Now it's important we discussed the repeat cycle for radar altimeters, and now you see that with ISAT this is a drawback. 91 days, it means that you have to wait roughly 3 months to get another measurements on the same position, and then you have always some drifting in the orbit, so it's not exactly the same position, as you will also see in the next slide. And another drawback is that this is a laser altimeter, a LiDAR, and so it means that the presence of clouds does not allow to retrieve any data. Here you see an investigation we performed recently over Lake Bracciano, lake located close to Rome, and you see the color coding the weak and strong beams, so the various pairs, first pair, second pair, third pair, and from these websites you can download the data and also have a quick look to check if the data are coherent or from the various bins, or if you have biases and so on. And as I told you, the position of the data can be different from time to time, and there can be some biases present. And sometimes you have data for all the 6 beams. In some other observations you have data for 4 beams, sometimes you have data for one single beam. So it all depends by the cloud coverage and by the specificity of the acquisition time. Presence of a lot of fields in the products helps the analysis. You have a subset for each beam. This one, for instance, you see it includes a lot of information, quality flags, and the orthometric height is provided, or it is provided also the ellipsoidal height, and you have also the significant wave height, I think, in one of the fields. Here it is, and so you have a lot of information, and you can infer the geoid used for the orthometric height in this field. So to make a quick analysis, essentially we took all the data for Lake Bracciano in the last 3 years since the beginning of the mission. We used a shapefile to filter the data. We applied this criterion to remove the outliers, mean plus minus twice the standard deviation, plus the quality flags evidenced in this paper. Please read these 3 papers because they are very useful. And then, to make the long story very short, we derived a time series for the weak beams and one for the strong beams. So we merged all the information, which means that for a single pass we filtered the data according to the criterion I showed you, and then we made the median of all the valid estimates, and we derived a point. And the same was made for all the months and for by considering all the beams, strong or weak beams. Then we applied a demeaning to compare to the in-situ data provided by local authorities, and then we see that the results that we obtained with ISAT are very good. The correlation coefficient is perfect, 99%. The accuracy is below 2 cm in both cases, and the RMSE is better for the weak beams, less than 2 cm, and around 3 cm for the strong beams. And in this case, this is due, this difference, especially because we are missing an information from the strong beams at this month. The red is missing, as you can see, red is strong, and it's missing because the orbit in this month just allowed having these 2 measurements, and one from the strong beam was filtered out either by a quality flag or by the shapefile we used. So you see that it's pretty important to understand what you're looking at, and in comparison to Samosa++, we presented this in a poster to LPS Living Planet Symposium, and it's a conference we are having every, I think, 2 years. And as you can see, we have We have this time series from in-situ data, and we are covering a different time interval because ISAT started at the end of 2018. And here you see that the difference in terms of standard deviation between altimeter and in-situ is about 6 centimeters, and the error bar is 4 centimeters. So the values are, as expected, higher than ISAT, but the good point for radar altimeters is that they can operate with clouds, with cloud presence, and they can operate providing results for Sentinel-3 with a repeat cycle of 27 days. And this is last slide about ISAT-2 is just to show you that in case of dumps, it can be very useful because it perfectly retrieves water levels on both sides of the dam. So please keep this in mind for your investigations. Now, how to use ISAT-2 and FFSAR for hydrology models. Essentially, this work made by Karina Nielsen at DTU considered the Canadian River in the Mississippi, see the figure here. Then all the data were acquired, the Sentinel-3 and ISAT data. For Sentinel-3, we also used data processed, sorry, for here you see the Sentinel-3 products, but in this figure the FFSAR is processed with CryoSAT-2 data. And so the ISAT-2 data LT13 product was used to derive the water level along the river, so you can have a look. This is the distance from this outreach. And it's interesting because you can derive the river profile and understand how the water evolves over the river profile. And you can see that FFSAR data produced by using these options match pretty well the ISAT data, which is a very good news, except for a few cases in which you have contamination, and this is clear because, as discussed, the across-track resolution of the fully focused SAR is, in any case, not good, and some contamination can be included, as we have seen. Then, by including this data in a state space model, essentially the results have been compared to in-situ data, and you can see that, of course, the ISAT-2 data required have a repeat cycle of 91 days, the FFSAR have a repeat cycle of 1 year with CryoSAT-2, so we cannot be everywhere when we can have acquired data when the peak in-situ data is happening. So we cannot pretend to reconstruct perfectly the in-situ data for this reason. If we would have a repeat cycle of a few days, this would be perfect probably. And here you can see, in any case, that the matchings between the in-situ data and the model run with the altimetry data is pretty good, providing an RMSE of 30 centimeters and a correlation of 0.6. So, and the results are also similar for all the retracker used for the analysis. The conclusion that I want to leave to you is that the radar and laser altimetry provide high quality data for inland water investigations that can be used in synergy, it means as seen in the last analysis, to correctly derive a river profile with ISAT-2 for data filtering, or also to ingest data in hydrologic models. ISAT-2 data could replace in-situ data in regions for which in-situ data are not available. So please keep in mind my analysis over Lake Bracciano. Accuracy is around 2 centimeters. So it means that you have the perfect data in case you are studying a region not including tide gauges. Try to have a look at the availability of ISAT-2 data. If they are present, you can create a time series and use this as in-situ data to compare to radar measurements. Inland water geophysical corrections, wet tropospheric correction in particular, play an important role for radar altimetry. Please always check the quality of the corrections you are using. Moreover, the FFSAR can be operated on Sentinel-3 and CryoSAT-2 with some limitation. Please keep in mind this point because Sentinel-3 and CryoSAT-2 are using a closed burst transmission scheme, which produces side lobes in the impulsive response of the system. A thing that would have required more time to be explained, but we didn't have all this time. So, but I just want to tell you that if you consider Sentinel-6 data, this new implemented open burst transmission scheme allows having no side lobes in the impulsive response. So, the best fully focused SAR in terms of data quality is with Sentinel-6. Then, the Earth Console Ultimate Virtual Lab offers a variety of innovative processors and processing options that allow the correct retrieval of inland water levels, as demonstrated in this analysis. To provide you some additional training material and inland water data providers, I prepared this slide. Please consider the Coastal Altimetry Workshop series. You will find a lot of presentations about coastal altimetry and also a training section with plenty of lectures that can help you in understanding even more what we have discussed today. The second link is about videos associated with the RUS training, in which the BRAT toolbox is used and explained in detail. So if you want to perform some simple analysis, you can consider the RUS training, downloading the BRAT toolbox reported here. Then the Panoply software has been extensively discussed in this presentation, and then important is that there are water levels that are ready-made and can be found in these services, the Hydroweb and the IT services. Here you find a database with plenty of inland water measurements, the data ready to use, and please have a look. Maybe they can be helpful for your analysis. So I'm ready to answer your questions, and I thank you a lot for having invited me. It was truly a pleasure for me to have the possibility to present these activities, and thanks a lot. As some additional time is available, I show you a few more slides in which we discuss especially the future altimetry missions from ESA and also from NASA. This first slide is about additional info on altimetry processors in AVL, and to complement the information I gave you before, I tell you that we have three additional processors. These are described in our user manual that you can find on the Earth Console website. This link is also cited at the end of the brochure we have seen before. And you can see that these three additional processors are mostly focused on Sentinel-6, two of them, and on fully focused cell processing. Especially the first is the ground processing prototype for L1A data developed by ESARSAT in the frame, of course, of the Sentinel-6 mission. The other one is the fully focused SAR for Sentinel-3 and Sentinel-6 by Aresis, before we discuss the diversion for CryoSat-2. So this is just an extension to the Sentinel-3 and Sentinel-6 missions, which is of course very useful for the inland water domain because you have a very good repeat cycle with these two missions. Then the SMAP for Sentinel-3 processor by CLS is another processor for fully focused SAR processing, and essentially it's something that you can check by yourself because this processor has been developed during an ESA ESTEC activity that we followed, and you can find the processor freely available at this GitHub address. The description is reported here, the code can be downloaded, it can be studied. It has been written in Python, so it's very easy to follow. And that's it for these additional processors. Then another processor that was developed in the past is the DDoF processor. And this is an unfocused SAR processor, and it is also written in Python. It is freely available at this address reported here. And as for SMAP, users are able to explore the DDoF code, understanding its possibilities, and also it is possible to modify the code to implement your own routines or to extend the code. And so it depends by what you want to do. You can modify the code and achieve your goal. Important, no retrackers are included. So, for instance, in this case, you may want to implement a simple threshold peak retracker, like the one cited in the first part of this talk, or also the OCOG. And these two processors, DDoP and SMAP, are very useful because you can have a clear view of both the unfocused SAR with DDoP and the fully focused SAR with SMAP. Now let's move ahead, and discuss the next missions. As you know, we have discussed the Sentinel-3 mission. The Sentinel-3A and Sentinel-3B are already operative, whereas Sentinel-3C and Sentinel-3D are planned for the future. You can see here an overview also on the years, the launching dates for these missions, and then we will discuss also the Crystal mission. Regarding the Sentinel-3 missions, I will not spend too much on this slide. You can see here all the instruments and brief descriptions on the applications and the benefits. Importantly, these are the two launching dates for Sentinel-3 and Sentinel-3B, so you note that we have plenty of data for these two missions. And then the planned launch dates for the Sentinel-3C and Sentinel-3D. And that's what I wanted to say. Of course, this presentation will be provided to you and will also be made available on the Earth Console website, so you'll have all the time to read and to go in detail by reading all the text and checking again all the information I provided in this talk. Then another mission that may be of interest are the following ones, and for us, for people doing altimetry, especially the Crystal mission is very important. Crystal stands for Copernicus Polar Ice and Snow Topography Altimeter, and you can see that it intends to provide information on sea ice thickness, ice sheets and glaciers, snow, polar oceanography, but also to support coastal and inland waters altimetry. Regarding this mission, it's important to underline that it will carry for the first time a dual frequency Ku and Ka band radar altimeter, and then there will also be a microwave radiometer, and this will measure and monitor sea ice thickness, overlying snow depth, and ice sheets elevation. The Crystal data will support maritime operation in the polar oceans and contribute to a better understanding of climate processes. Also, applications related to open ocean, coastal, and inland water will be supported. You can see that there are two antennas, so also interferometry will be possible. The launch is planned in 2017, sorry, 2027, the first satellite. And in the next slide, you will see the outcome of the dual cryo workshop. And this workshop served the purpose of confirming and consolidating the science case for dual band altimetry from Crystal and promoting this mission's timely and rapid implementation. This is particularly important given the prospect of a gap in polar observations poleward of 82 degrees in latitude, which are at present provided by CREASAT2 and ICESat2. So this is a very important point, and please check the video available here to have some more information and also a nice view on the capabilities of Crystal. Here at this web address, you may find all the information about the dual cryo workshop, and you will find all the presentations and especially a report, the final report of the workshop, in which all the information on the contributions and also a summary are provided. To conclude this talk, let's present this slide about the Surface Water Ocean Topography Mission, SWOT. And this satellite mission has been developed to make the first global survey of Earth's surface water, observe the fine details of the ocean's surface topography, and measure how water bodies change over time. SWOT is being jointly developed by NASA, CNES, and also with contributions from the Canadian Space Agency and the United Kingdom Space Agency. Launch is targeted for November 2022, so it's pretty close, and you find more info at this link. This is kind of a very important illustration because the big innovation is here. You can see that the SWOT is not a single SWOT like the one you have for typical altimeters that we have discussed in this presentation, but you have this configuration, and this is due to the fact that we are using this new instrument technology developed in the Karin radar, and it's a radar interferometry, and Karin will measure ocean and surface water level over this very wide swath that you can see. And there will be also a gap along nadir, and it operates in two modes, low resolution mode and high resolution mode, and it includes also a JSON class altimeter that will collect data in the gap between the Karin swaths. So we have three swaths. One is related to the use of this JSON class altimeter, and the other one is related to the Karin instrument, and then you have a list of also of the other instruments that complement the mission. And this is all. If you want to know more, again, please check this website. There have been many investigations to support this mission that of course will provide a great contribution to these investigations. And so I thank you very much, and I'm ready to answer your questions. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Marco, for this detailed and wonderful lecture. Here we have a few questions. So the first question is, how much percentage of errors are reduced in the closed-loop tracking for obtaining water levels waveforms? Are this closed-loop phenomena use post-processing algorithm of normalization, or it's related to sensor pulse phenomena?
Excuse me, can you please show me the question in the chat? Because we have
Yeah,
some
sure.
problem with the audio. Well, the percentage of errors, the reduction in the errors are dependent on the specific scenario you are studying. The point is that the closed loop is something dictated with the acquisition of the waveform. So if it's not well managed before acquiring the waveforms, if the window is not well centered, you cannot recover the data. And so it's something that you lose, and actually you cannot retrieve good quality data afterwards. So as I said, for the case of Sentinel-3, you have to check the operative mode, the tracking mode implemented for your specific target, and then see the data that you can get. After you perform the analysis, considering all the data that you have available, and using the filtering strategies that we have seen in the investigation, you perform your analysis. The possibility of doing some comparison between closed loop and open loop was made probably in this paper I cited about SAR-RTK, because for SAR-RTK it is possible to have both loops, and a test was made in the first cycles of the mission. But then I think that they had some problems with the DEM on board, memory issues or something like this. So probably SAR-RTK is now using the closed loop. And so it's not something that you can recover. It's basically dictated by the tracking, and it's only on the operative side, which means that it has to be accounted by the ground segment team, by the team managing the instrument. And actually, when you get the data, if the data are there, you can perform the analysis. If not, there is nothing you can do.
So the next question is, let's say I want to do a time series analysis over a particular water body. Do I need to download the along track data one, or there is a way I can download the data and see all the time series data? Then I can conduct the various correction. This is for both Sentinel-3 and ICED-2.
I think you mean if you have to download the data one by one, or there is some tool available to see the time series directly. I think that for ISAT-2, this is probably easier, because if you go to this website indicated in doing the analysis over Lake Bracciano, they have this visualization tool allowing you to see how the water evolves for the specific pass. So it's not a time series, of course, of a few months or over the different acquisition times, but it's for the single pass. And then you can look at least at the gaps or the quality of the data. For Sentinel-3, you have to download the data from the Copernicus Sci-Hub and do the analysis on your own at the moment. Or you can consider these services like DAITI, for instance, or HydroWeb, in which you can query the data for the time of interest and have the visualization of the time series, I think. So probably it's better if you can have a look at these services, if you want to have a quick look of the data, the quality of the data on your water body. And then you have to consider that these providers sometimes mostly use the official data. And so what we offer in the Altimetri Virtual Lab is a processing which can be tailored for the different scenarios. And this means that, for instance, the Samosa Plus Plus data can be found only on the Earth console, Altimetri Virtual Lab. And this is a very important point, because if you check the publications that have been made in the coastal zone and in the water domain, in Europe, as well as also in China, by different teams, which were conducting very detailed investigations over lakes, testing several retrackers, several processing strategies, you will note that this Samosa Plus and Samosa Plus Plus retracker are quite appreciated by the community. There are also other options for empirical retrackers, but also considering what reported at the Sentinel-3 validation team meetings, these are among the best retrackers you can get. And so by my point of view, it's you can start, of course, from these services like HydroWeb DAITI to have a look at what you can get for your specific case. You can investigate the open loop and closed loop with Sentinel-3 with the website I provided. With ISAT-2, you can manage the analysis as I made in my slides to have a quick look at the data and also to perform the analysis against in situ data. And then you see, if you want to do more, if Sentinel-3 data are not good enough for you, probably it's important to consider additional strategies and processing options provided only in the Salvatore for Sentinel-3 within the Altimetri Virtual Lab. Well, about CryoSat, as I said in the first slide, you have to download the mod mask. And so it works in LRM mode, in SAR mode, and in SARIN mode, so in SAR interferometer. And the mask is changed from time to time because it's managed by the CryoSat-2 team, which means that all these missions, no, and we perform research activities on them. And sometimes, because we want to study a specific region which is of interest, because it can be particularly challenging or important for climate change, this requires the changing of the mode mask. And so it means that this mask is not something which is completely fixed. Of course, there are very important regions like the poles, which are always covered. But some smaller areas can be inserted or have been inserted in the past that were not present in the first, for instance, development of the CryoSat-2 mod mask. Regarding the quality of the retrackers, this is, I think, one of the open points because it depends by the regions that you want to study. From what we noted is that for our retrackers, those again discussed before, Samosa Plus performs very well for the coastal zone, the inland water domain. The ELS Plus is also very appreciated by the climate change community, very used to produce the SLCCI, the so-called sea level climate change initiative data sets, which are used for climate change monitoring. And so as I discussed in the presentation, it depends by the waveform you have, by the morphology of the scenario, the contamination included, and this leads you to choose a retracker or the other. This cited retracker, the threshold, the OCOG, these were the choices before having the Samosa Plus for the inland water. So these were useful and were particularly used in the LRM domain. Then they are still used, of course, and you can find, for instance, the OCOG in the Sentinel-3 official product, as well also the threshold peak retracker and the ice retracker are present also in the CryoSat-2 official product. So it depends by what you want to do. And it's typically seen that there are authors publishing papers making a comparison, comparing different retracker estimates to provide some information about the best retracker to use. So I would say it's an open question. It's always better to don't have in mind the idea that a retracker can be used everywhere, anytime, but have the be informed about the fact that there are always two or three retrackers to be tested. And for the inland water domain, for instance, we have seen retrackers implemented by Salvatore Di Nardo, so the developer of Samosa Plus, and we've seen this analysis with OCOG or another Empirica retracker developed by DTU, which considered the previous waveforms, their trend, the way they behaved, to retrack the actual waveform. And so there is also, because it's important for inland water domain to maintain the position of the reflection from the water. And so you need also information, you may also need information from the preceding waveforms. So you see the discussion is pretty wide, and I suggest you just to test two or three retrackers that from the community papers are considered reliable and check the one that fits the best your needs.
Thank you very much, Dr. Marco. We are very much obliged that you took time from your precious time out of your.
Let me check this last series of question. The gate number is something that you can check in the technical documents to shape. If you want to check to shape your tracker. And it is if you are referring to the tracking gate, it is fixed, and the value can be reported is reported in the associated technical documentation. It varies, for instance, between CryoSat-2 and Sentinel-3, and both are SAR, so it doesn't vary between SAR and LRM. It depends by the way the retracker the instrument has been conceived, but usually this waveform, this information is provided in the technical documents. The SGDR and GDR are products from JSON, and they include different information. If I remember correctly, the S include more information from the scientists, which means the A1B waveforms and other parameters that can be used by researchers. But we are mostly using ESA data, and so you can check the associated documentation to be sure. About Samosa++, this is a retracker which is quite specific. So it performs better than Samosa Plus in some regions and performs worse in the other. We are still performing some analysis with Samosa Plus. And so I would say that an analysis like the one we showed for the Great Salt Lake cannot be definitive. And so in this case, we have seen that Samosa Plus is more robust in its results, and Samosa Plus needs more filtering to produce better estimates. So again, it's not something like you read the double plus and you think that it's better, because if not, we would have removed the Samosa Plus from our options, no? There would have been no reason to maintain two retrackers that perform the same, or having one retracker that performs worse than the other. So it's important to continue the development of the retrackers, and the Samosa Plus performed better, for instance, for the Lake Bracciano, one of the last slides I presented, even if I didn't underline this. So again, it's about testing the options like we made in an analysis to understand the improvements that have to be done, for instance, in Samosa++, and also to, again, compare the outputs of the retracker, because they are scenario dependent, as I said. And again, the last question is about what I said before. So it's, again, don't think that one retracker can be in principle better than others, and just take into account to test a few retrackers for your analysis and perform your investigation. Okay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Marco, for giving your precious time out of your very busy schedule and guiding our students whenever they needed any help. And it's our opportunity that Dr. Jerome is also here with us. So, Jerome, it will be we will be very much honored if you want to say a few words for the participants.
Yeah, hello everyone. Well, Marco Restano did an excellent job in delivering a very nice talk, a very dense and also full of information that you can certainly you will certainly need to go back and look and see the details in different product user manuals and mission description documents and so on. So we do have many missions. And what I would like to say is that there's a very bright future for altimetry, because as you saw in Marco's presentation, we have plans to launch satellites with altimeters in the next 20, 30 years. And that means basically forever, just like meteorological satellites. So I would encourage students to enter the field and exploit this data. They are guaranteed that they will get from Europe, European programs, either the European Space Agency or the European Union, the Copernicus program, some interesting data. And I would also like to say that we had the pleasure to welcome a lot of people from Pakistan in different workshops, either the Coastal Altimetry workshops or the hydrospace workshop. I put in the chat for everyone the reference of the report from the last hydrospace workshop that we held in June 2021. And we are certainly going to be organizing this workshop again in a couple of years. We are also organizing the 13th of the series of the Coastal Altimetry Workshop, either at the end of this year or the beginning of the next one, probably in Cadiz space. We have in the past reserved some budget in the workshop organization to give grants for students, early career scientists, to participate in the workshop. And of course, now that we are getting used to the hybrid concept, it will be easier for many, many other students to attend even virtually. And so the future is quite bright in terms of altimetry data. Also, you just have to consider that you must use all altimetry data, because the altimeter is only flying back in so much time. So we're trying to push the space-time sampling as much as possible, but it's important to use all available data from different space agencies, like Europe, of course, the US, China, and India, and others who want to enter the field, of course, they're most welcome. And so please use all the data together, not just, you know, from one source. And also what we're doing is that we are more and more trying to get access to river discharge. So there's been a lot of papers on the subject, and that requires using other types of data, like imaging instruments, like Olchi or Sluster on Sentinel-3 and their equivalent on other agencies' spacecraft. And the other thing is that I'd like to say that the in-situ data is very important, because we use it either for validation or for strengthening the retrieval algorithms, the retrieval process. And so it would be very nice to make available as much in-situ data that you have over rivers, like river gauges, and even better river discharge variables that are measured on the ground. And so I'm very happy that we could contribute to your workshop. It looks pretty dense. I saw the program, and very eclectic. And I wish you best wishes, and especially a bright future for all the students.
Thank you very much. Thanks once again. We look forward to working with you in the future.